Welcome to the fifth week of the Powering Agriculture MOOC on Sustainable Energy for Food. Within that initiative, USAID, the governments of Sweden and Germany, as well as Duke Energy and OPIC, promote clean energy solutions in the agriculture and food sector. For the MOOC, the partners are cooperating with TH Chem, a university of applied science based in Cologne, Germany.
Hello. I'm happy to welcome you to the fifth week of the Powering Agriculture MOOC. During this week, you will get familiarized about different policies and regulations relevant for the Energy-Agriculture Nexus and energy use in general. We will also talk about the social and economic impacts of energy production and use, how we can respond to increasing resource scarcity by using the concepts of circular economy, and last but not least, about market and financing challenges and opportunities for promoting energy efficiency solutions in the agricultural sector. Let us start by considering two statistical facts. Presently, more than 1.2 billion people do not have access to electricity, and 2.7 billion people rely on firewood, crop straws, and animal dung for their energy needs. In most cases, these traditional fuels are used in ways which are not efficient, detrimental for human health, and often bad for environment. To achieve sustainable development goals, such as eradicating poverty and hunger, mitigating climate change, achieving gender equality, and promoting healthy lives, we need to make sure that everybody has access to clean, reliable, and affordable energy, which by itself is a sustainable development goal. This is also important in the energy-agriculture nexus. Innovations and widespread adoptions of clean and efficient energies in agriculture and agricultural value chains would stimulate increases in productivity, improve rural incomes and food security, not least by creating new business opportunities and jobs. To achieve that purpose, we need enabling institutions, regulations and policies. This is not always easy. Political economy plays a key role in the development of the renewable energy sector. The existing potentials for renewable energies are not always fully utilized because such policies and regulations are rarely purely technical outcomes, but often are the results of a broader social and political bargaining. Of course, the government's role is to create conditions for efficient functioning of energy and agriculture markets. However, efficient markets may not necessarily result in outcomes which are environmentally sustainable or socially equitable. So there is a role for the government action to correct these market failures. But there are also risks associated with government failures. When government interventions aimed at correcting market failures lead to even bigger inefficiencies and misallocation of resources. This may happen, for example, due to excessive influence of specific lobbying interests on government decisions. In such contexts, successful policies for promoting renewable energies set clear incentives and use market mechanisms, base government action on societal support, involve local governments and civil society. As a result, the renewable energy sector involves a host of regulations and policies, such as renewable energy mandates, which require producing a certain share of energy from renewable sources. For example, Mexico City mandated all new swimming pools to cover 30% of their energy needs for water heating from solar energy. A related approach is setting renewable energy targets, which are the commitments to generate a certain share of total energy using renewable sources. For example, Germany targets to generate 35% of its electricity from renewable energy sources by 2020. Feed-in tariffs guarantee the purchase of the generated renewable energy with a long-term contract and at cost-based purchase prices. Under this scheme, electricity generated using solar panels can receive higher prices than, for example, from the fossil fuel-based electricity generator. There is a substantial potential for the application of this tool in agriculture as well. For example, in irrigation schemes that are powered by solar panels. Net metering and flexible grid access enable small-scale renewable energy producers for example, households with rooftop solar energy generation to sell the amount of electricity beyond their own needs to the central grid. In addition to such regulation-based approaches, governments also use a variety of fiscal tools, such as lowering taxes for renewable energy production, providing subsidies, grants, and low-interest loans. Ultimate objectives of such regulations are increasing energy use efficiency and transition to cleaner energy sources. Energy use efficiency measures may include eco-labels, which certify environmental friendliness of various consumer and industrial products, retrofitting existing buildings for higher energy efficiency, including in farm buildings, public campaigns at promoting positive behavioral change for reducing the waste of energy. The transition to clean energies could follow three approaches. The energy ladder approach implies that with increasing income, energy users abandon less efficient and cheap traditional bioenergy and shift to intermediate energy sources, such as charcoal and coal, and then to modern, safer and more efficient sources such as electricity. On the other hand, the energy stacking means that there is no unique and linear energy transition process, but energy consumers use multiple energy sources. At the same time, their choice is influenced by a multitude of socioeconomic and cultural preferences. Finally, energy leapfrogging means a rapid transition to clean and more efficient energy technologies, bypassing the intermediate polluting energy sources. The transition to cleaner energies is not only a global or national level process, but starts at every home. The stakes from using cleaner energies are not less, but arguably even more vital at the household and community levels. Energy is a crucial input to all economic activities. Every product we use, every service we receive, embodies some amount of energy. There is a very high correlation between energy use and economic growth, even though there are several countries now who have successfully started decoupling economic growth from energy use through higher energy use efficiency. The reliance on coal and oil to fuel global economic growth is contributing to environmental pollution and global warming. At the same time, the world needs more and more energy, which now needs to come from renewable and clean sources. That's why modern renewable energy is important to meet these energy needs in a sustainable manner. Access to clean, reliable, and affordable energy, especially in the rural areas of the developing countries, would help reduce poverty, enhance food security, lead to healthier lives, and promote gender equity. Research shows that access to electricity in rural areas could reduce infant malnutrition through its impacts on female labor. It can also allow for less deforestation, less indoor air pollution, better public safety with street lighting, better education because children will be able to study after dark, and many other benefits. Transition to renewable energies is also needed for another related reason. The predominant mode of economic organization is presently centered on so-called linear economy, built around the make-use-dispose model. Under linear economy, many negative externalities of resource extraction, production, consumption, and disposing are not included in their prices. For example, coal-based power plant may create significant amount of pollution, negatively affecting the health of people in the surrounding areas who have not willingly agreed to incur this cost. For them, this is a negative externality. The true social cost of the linear economy, including all the externalities, is very high, making it unsustainable. Circular economy, on the other hand, is a mode of economic organization which seeks to minimize resource use and promote adoption of cleaner technologies. It's opposed to the linear economy concept. Circular economy calls for minimizing the new resource extraction and instead maximizing the reuse and recycling of already extracted resources. In this mode of economic organization, there is no waste, and so-called waste from one production process or consumption becomes an input to another production process. Circular economy requires that all energy to be produced from renewable or otherwise sustainable sources. Agricultural production presents ample opportunities for a rapid transition to circular economy. Such approaches like conservation agriculture, which reduces fuel use, or applications of solar energy for irrigation water pumping, reuse of organic waste for producing compost, can help in reducing the environmental impact of agricultural production and food systems in general. Agriculture Energy Nexus also provides ample opportunities for business development based on renewable energy solutions. To start with, all markets are part of value chains. For example, dairy value chain may start with livestock farming, whose product milk would then serve as input to milk processors, who produce a variety of dairy products, which are then go to retailers, and from them to consumers. But this conventional view of value chain may no longer be sufficient, due to existence of often close links among numerous related value chains. They need to be viewed as value webs, consisting of several interlinked chains. Any changes in one of the chains will have repercussions all across the value web. So when starting a business in one part of a value chain, if business planners are aware of developments in the entire value web, they may increase their profit opportunities. There are already promising uses of solar energy at various stages of agricultural value chains, including for irrigation water pumping, water desalination, drying crops and forages, for heating greenhouses, for refrigeration in post-harvest management. Economic viability of renewable energy applications in agriculture depends on availability of effective demand, which can pay for the delivered goods and services. Cost competitiveness of renewable energy with fossil fuels. Enabling regulations about which I talked earlier, such as government subsidies and access to other sources of capital and know-how, such as private investments or credits, or development grants and loans. Financing needs for providing sufficient access to the renewable energy in the agricultural sector are substantial. Small-scale renewable energy investments are often not interesting for the capital markets or private banks, which prefer to work with large actors to cut down on their operational costs and for better risk management. This makes the role of government and development partners indispensable. Financial constraints or lack of credit are the key determinants of long-term sustainability of renewable energies and include not only upfront installation costs, but also costs of operation and management of projects over time. Private-public partnerships and community collective action through pooling of resources can play a critical role in the successful implementation of local small-sized renewable energy projects. Coming to the end of introduction to this week, I would like to summarize several points that you may want to look into if you are thinking about deploying clean energy solutions in the agricultural sector. A good starting point would be to identify the value chain and broader value web that you will be operating. Business and financial planning based on the ground research needs to be done to see if business would be viable, where to get initial funding, how to finance operations, which technology, which inputs, what outputs. This also involves considering if regulations provide with any incentives, such as soft loans, subsidies, and tax reductions. The crucial aspect, what is the time horizon? Are these incentives permanent, one time, or with some expiry date? Thank you very much for watching. This is it for now. You can read in more detail about the issues I have highlighted now in the reading material provided with the course.
Thank you for your attention, and see you next week.